Before we get to the comprehensive permit, got a bit of housekeeping on another case just to take care of first. In our packet in front of us, we have to correct a misnomer and an address on a previous decision regarding a property that is rightfully Springvale Road, 64 Springvale Road in Reading. And in the decision that we rendered, we identified the property as Springdale Road. And so we need to add an addendum to that decision to get the address right. So I would, I guess, really quickly entertain a motion from a board member to amend the decision to reflect that the correct address is 64 Springvale Road.
So moved.
We have a second?
Second.
Any discussion on that?
Oh, okay.
Well, we're going to do that in each case that the address comes up, right? In the decision as well as the...
Well, this. So what we're going to do is we're going to add an addendum to this decision that's already been drawn up for us that corrects the misnomer in the address.
Okay.
And if that comes up again, I would imagine that's how we do it again.
Okay.
All right. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Any opposed? None. Carries unanimously. I'll sign this and we'll turn it in.
There you go.
Can you sign it right now?
No, I'm going to wait another 26 minutes. Yep. I got two of them, so you can have this one.
All right. So we need the two.
Oh, we both.
Yeah.
You need the decision back too?
I'll take it.
Oh yeah, this is the original.
Yeah.
It's the stamp.
It's
one.
A,
or is
it's
that a
test
copy?
No,
okay.
It's a test. So.
All right, close the hearing on that matter. And we will. Open the continuation of the hearing on case number 1602, the Reading Village Comprehensive Permit. I'll read the notice into the record. Continuation of a public hearing in the Great Room at the Pleasant Street Senior Center, 49 Pleasant Street, Reading, Massachusetts, on Thursday, December 15th at a little after 7 p.m. on the petition of MKM Reading LLC, who seeks a comprehensive permit to develop 72 units of rental housing on approximately 42,342 square feet of residentially zoned land under Mass General Laws 40B, Section 2023, with waivers from zoning requirements on the property located at 3141 Lincoln Street and 212 Prescott Street in Reading, Massachusetts. We're going to go ahead and conduct the hearing tonight. This is designed to be our final hearing night, barring any further discussion between the applicant and the board. I'm going to give a brief update on process. We'll perhaps hear from the applicant. I'd also like to get some commentary from the board. We will open up the matter to public discussion and any comments from town staff or town council. Talk about what we need to talk about and go from there. Any comments from the during the public comment session should be addressed to the board, and we will make a determination as to whether or not any further comment is necessary. We'd like that to be civil, as it has been all along. So in terms of board process with the application, I spent some time this morning on the matter, which was the only time that I had over the past week. We had a flurry of activity, probably in excess of 15 or so emails, back and forth submissions, updating, and I managed to find some time this morning to spend on the matter. So I'd like to outline the process, and I want to give the applicant an opportunity to address this and work with the board and town staff to come to a mutually beneficial decision, one that benefits the town and the applicant. we have to talk about whether or not, I think, the board would want to talk about with the applicant whether or not that decision can be rendered tonight, however, and we can certainly talk about that. Several responses and updates have gone back and forth. You know, we opened this matter on February 4th, 2016. Board and the staff have, we've been very patient with the applicant. You know, there have been some delays in information, and as has been the case leading up to even today, where we just received an updated plan today, you know, at the 11th hour. Whether or not that's acceptable, we've given some quarter to the applicant regarding that, but you know, I understand some other boards may not have been so patient in that regard, but you know, we really, the crux of this is we really need time to review this information as part of the process, and that part has been sorely lacking, I think, throughout this process with the last minute notice, you know, from receiving the plan of record today, you know, and I think those are items that are crucial to the board's ability to vet this application properly. In addition to that plan that we received today, we received updated waiver requests, a new proposal regarding the number of units, parking configuration, loading zone requests, among other information that, you know, is candidly of local concern. And those local concerns involve health, safety, environmental, planning concerns, as we've already discussed. As I said earlier, I haven't had a whole lot of time to review any of these materials in detail. And I'll also ask for some comment from other board members and town staff to see if we are in agreement that perhaps we may need more time and more of an opportunity, perhaps less than a day's notice, to review some of this information to be able to render a decision. I don't think this comes as necessarily news to the applicant. I mean, this has been a habit throughout the process of representing that deadlines can be met that are not, and then submitting information at the 11th hour. We've rolled with those punches, excuse me. And the record in this hearing is filled with instances of that information. So, speaking solely as the chair, I'm not sure that we have enough information to render a decision on the application tonight that would enable the applicant to get a shovel in the ground by springtime, which I understand is their goal. So I think tonight our time is better spent requesting what the board might feel, perhaps town staff might feel, is information necessary for the comprehensive permit application. Maybe perhaps if there are deliverables associated with that, and obtaining from the applicant, staff, and public comment, and perhaps discussing whether or not a decision can be rendered and a hearing can be closed today. If the applicant, you know, disagrees with that and they're entitled to, and perhaps not consent to provide this information and enable the board time to have it reviewed, then, you know, our hand may be forced, and we may be required to issue an application, you know, issue a decision and close the hearing without having what might be pertinent information, especially regarding the new waiver requests. You know, and we don't have or just got information sufficient to address these waivers. Again, certainly subject to discussion. You know, but if that goes down the path that could go down, then, you know, respectfully, the applicant may not get a shovel in the ground till the end of 2017 if they do it in 2017. So I have a couple of comments to make, and you know, I'll ask for some other board and staff comment on this. You know, based upon the notice that we received with regard to waiver requests and plan amendments, you know, particularly the on-site loading area impacts upon RMLD equipment, proximity to egress and ingress, you know, I query whether or not we require some additional peer review regarding those waiver requests and plan amendments. I understand having just briefly seen an email late today while I was out of the office that there was a telephone call as recent as this afternoon regarding some of those issues, and I don't know if issues have been resolved or if issues still remain, and you know, and I wonder if that's the case. I don't know whether or not the time has passed or whether the time is appropriate for you know, presentation regarding the utilization of this parcel and the deviation from the bylaws, especially related to the driveways, loading areas, or open space. We haven't heard anything regarding that being economically necessary, other than comment from the applicant that they feel that it is. You know, there's not been really any economic demonstration regarding that fact, and the board may be entitled to that. Last hearing, the applicant, one of the applicant's team, discussed that they perhaps would recommend a consultant that the town could work with or consider working with to vet any pro forma or economic information. We haven't gotten that information. Certainly, the town would want to have that under consideration if that was indeed necessary, and certainly would need time to retain and contact such a consultant. You know, the changes in density of this project bring to mind, and again, I don't have the entire record in front of me, but I don't know that we've heard anything regarding the whether or not this project conforms with the DHCD guidelines for high-density 40B projects. I think we can all agree that this is considered a high-density project, and you know, I'm thinking we might need some additional peer review or engineering review, at least, again, these are my thoughts, regarding proposed impacts on abutters, particularly as it relates to traffic safety regarding the location of the loading zone next to the entranceway, perhaps feedback from our RMLD regarding moving of the transformer, you know, input from daytime government and public safety on any impacts, if any, from that, and certainly anything regarding engineering review of impact on abutters from the project, particularly you know, perhaps stormwater and drainage runoff recharge plans. So those are my thoughts as I see them up until this point. A little bit of a, you know, a brief undertaking from my again, albeit brief review this morning of everything that's come in over the past 24 hours. And I think what I'd like to do is deviate a little bit from what we've done thus far. And I'd actually like to hear from other board members if they're so inclined regarding any concerns that they might have before we get into any new information or any other information. Does that, that sound acceptable to the board members? Applicant generally okay with that?
I'd like to respond to some of your comments, but I don't.
I'd be happy to give you time. I imagine you might hear some overlap, so rather than take them piecemeal, maybe we take them, you know, in the aggregate. That's okay. That okay?
You're the
good.
Okay.
Thanks.
Before we start with the rest of the board members and their input. I, like you, have not had a chance to digest everything we got in the last day and a half. I would like to hear from Julie. She's been coordinating this whole thing on what has been happening the last week and where we are exactly in terms of the process of vetting this as we've gone from, well, I'll say within the last week, new material that has come in, the impact on the project as it stands, conversations back and forth. I mean, the emails are running rampant. I see we're on everything from Facebook to whatever, all over the place. I feel like I'm sitting in the back seat and I don't even know what's going on. Could you give us a kind of an update from you, from where you're sitting, Julie, before we...
Is that something that sounds fair, Julie, that you'd be comfortable doing?
I can tell you what I know.
Okay.
I'm going to try not to make any opinions.
Okay.
So since we last met, the applicant has reduced the number of units to 68 and increased the number of parking spaces to 85, which includes, I believe, 25 compact spaces. They have proposed four different options for how to deal with the loading situation. which are outlined in the waiver request, which was most recently updated today, and you should have in front of you. The decision has been revised based on this information. It's before you as well. The hearing is supposed to close tonight without an extension of time from the applicant. I have sent all the materials to town staff, and I received feedback, which I included in a memo to you, which I sent you yesterday. It's also in front of you. The fire department, and the police department had no concerns with the new parking or loading configuration, the on-site loading configuration. There's a memo from the town engineer which outlines a few things for the applicant to be aware of. I personally don't see anything major in that memo. That's where we are. I think, Chris, you might want to say something.
Sure, please.
And I would just add a quick comment that as we sit here right now, we are currently under deadline to close the public hearing this evening, but there is no requirement, if that were to happen, there is no requirement that the board vote on anything tonight or come to any decision. The board has, once the public hearing closes, the board has an additional 40 days to render its decision on the application. And during that time, it can meet again and talk about the form of the decision, conditions it wants to impose, waivers it wants to grant or not grant. The board retains the ability to talk about the application and what it wants to do as a board. It is merely, once the public hearing closes, what is lost is the opportunity to take in additional information from either the applicant or from the public, or from consultants other than myself and staff.
And any hearings that the board would have would be open to the public and advertised in advance?
Absolutely. That it would look just like it looks tonight. It would just, there wouldn't be a component of the meeting where we're hearing from the applicant and the public. It would just be the board talking about what it wants to do.
But the public would be silent. They could listen, but not talk.
Absolutely.
And the applicant could be here, listen, unless they are questioned about something, they would not have any input back in.
That's right.
As no new information can be brought forward.
Exactly. The board gets to use all the information in the record, and I think myself and Jean and Julie can answer questions from the board, but no new outside information would be coming in from that point forward. Mm-hmm.
Anything else, John?
Not at this point. If you go around the table, I just...
Yeah, I think I'm still inclined to proceed as I had outlined before and get some feedback from the board, give the applicant an opportunity to be heard, hear from the public, and I think that's probably still a fair way to go. Mm-hmm. And so I'll just go in order and start with Robert. Are you... comfortable starting, Robert?
Sure, that's fine. And I think like John and David, it does get frustrating getting plans here at the last minute. David called it 11th hour. I might call it 11:45 p.m. by the time we get it. Later than that, it really gets frustrating. We don't have hard copies to review. We get copies via emails or attachments. Many times difficult to see on your home computer or on your iPads or whatever. I certainly much prefer to have a hard copy in front of me, and we don't get them. It gets very frustrating. Quickly looking at them tonight again, I think we still have questions in regards to the parking in the loading zones. Granted, we've reduced the developer has noted that they've reduced the number of units by 4 down to 68, increased the parking up to a number that allows a ratio of 1.25 spaces per unit. But this is using up to 25 compact spaces. I don't know how well that'll work on that. You know, I would, I saw town engineering look at it and they questioned the same thing. I would like to have a pier or a traffic study or something there look-see at it and, you know, is this adequate to have that number of compact parking spaces or not? I know town engineer was concerned in regards to some of the width of the aisles. I believe the width of the aisles are 24 feet for the two-way traffic. And in some cases now there's one-way traffic in aisles and that's been reduced down to, I think at the minimum, about 18 feet. It may work, may not. Again, I would be bowing to an expert on that in regards to what their thoughts were on it. Concern that I had all along was the loading zone. We've gone back and forth on that for 4 months, 5 months on loading zones. Finally, we get an on-site loading zone. I see in my packet tonight, not stamped by an engineer. It's just an additional plan. I assume this is one that came in today or last minute again, because it certainly doesn't agree with the plan that's in the packet that supposedly we got updated plans on, sheet 5. No loading zone is shown on site. Now we have an on-site loading zone where they've put it where a transformer was. Now the transformer's been relocated and they've lost the parking space. It gets frustrating. I don't know if this is gonna work. I think we need our traffic people to be taking a look at this and telling us if in fact it's gonna work. So we've eliminated a parking space on this plan with the loading zone, and I don't know if you know, you can just take the transformer and decide to relocate it when you feel like it. Has you know RMLD been brought into this at all? So like you, David, and I think John was the same thing. You get very frustrated with the whole process here and dealing with it, and I don't think it's just been this board that's been frustrated. I think there's been some other boards in town that have gone through the same thing. So that's pretty much it, David. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Bob. John.
Well, the expectation and the role of the ZBA, Zoning Board of Appeals, in 40Bs is to listen to the developer and grant waivers to approve a project to increase the number of low and moderate income affordable housing in the community to reach the 10%. So this board is being asked to grant you, meaning the applicant, a permit to do this. And within that permit, you are submitting to us those things which you believe would be appropriate for the community. In terms of the way it was set up, we started in February, and in February we had a project which had significant smaller area to build upon, but with the same number of units that you're asking for today, without the modification of just this last week. I think it was the July meeting we had. You were able to acquire another piece of property, and we changed the whole project. So here we are. Approaching that 180 days again with the extensions that you have granted the board over time. And I think that was a 190 day and 130 day. I can't remember. But the intention is that once that new piece of property was acquired and you included that in the new proposal, in my mind, you started a whole new proposal before the board. We had to shift gears, we had to move a lot of things around. So I still think there's easily 30 to 45 days left in this new proposal that you have projected to us. That's one thought. Second, the board can grant you, certainly, a permit to move forward on this if it's pushed, but may not be pushed with, maybe inclusive of conditions that you're not going to find appropriate to yourselves and what you propose to the town. The board has got to come up with justifications for that. The major conditions are going to be predicated on, number one, safety to the community and the neighborhood, and the impact on the neighborhood and the town, and its location relative to the MBTA or the major transit line. You've changed it substantially in the last 7 plus or minus days, and the catch-all seems to be the same thing. It's the parking. All the parking came in initially at the 9x18 parking spaces, normal parking spaces. You reduced that to 70% normal parking spaces, 29.4% compact parking, and then you want to use part of the standard parking for the loading zones. That I'm still trying to get my mind around exactly how that's going to happen. When you put it down here, I mean, it doesn't meet the requirements, but certainly it's a lot better in my mind than putting it out in the street. Because if that's the question, if you're going out onto town property and town roadways, I would ask the same question I asked the last time we were here, and that would be the town council. Who's liable should there be a major accident out there if the selectmen were to grant you that opportunity and there was a catastrophe? Who stands for that? Is that you? Is that the town at whole? Certainly not the Zoning Board of Appeals. So I'm looking at that also. So I would like certainly to be able to digest this a little bit more. Impact on the neighborhood, the traffic, between 7 and 9 a.m. and then again 5 to 7 p.m. I mean, that's the major portion. You had indicated that you were going to seek other opportunities for overnight parking, perhaps working something out with MBTA, so that your renters could utilize some of that parking as long as they're out of there by a particular time. I happen to sit the what's our other project on West Street, all apartments? Archstone?
Mm-hmm.
Is that Archstone ready?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yep. Whatever. Much of that decision could be very easily mirrored in something like this. It was much more extensive than what we're asking for right here in the proposed brief that was given to us that I haven't had time to go through. Page by page. I mean, I think we need an attorney or something. And then the last issue that I have is if indeed the board renders a decision in the affirmative with conditions after the 40 days, when Bob was here, Mr. Engler was here, he mentioned that he would be able to give us some names of individuals and we can go out and recruit names of individuals who could find out if what the conditions are that we're proposing is financially feasible for you to make your profit based upon the mass housing standards or requirements. So I'm looking at all these things and trying to get them in perspective, and I can't quite do that if we're trying to make a decision tonight, because I think, as David said, if we try to rush this thing, it's going to go back to mass housing if the board has a list of conditions that don't meet your requirements, then we have to go out and find somebody to rule on that. Then we have to go to mass housing. We're talking about, who knows, another 6-9 months before you can get a shovel in the ground. I'd like to get it done ASAP, but I can't, in my mind, I can't get it done by making a decision at night one way or the other. So I just throw that out there.
Town council would like to
respond.
I got just one point that I want to clarify a little bit, and that is on the subject of, well, there may be areas of it, where the board needs more information from the applicant or from staff or others in town in order to make an informed decision, and we can certainly talk about that for the rest of tonight. But on the subject of economic information from the applicant, and specifically pro formas, the way that works is as follows. When we broke last time, the board had announced a couple of conditions and waiver denials that it expected to impose, and the applicant had the opportunity to present information that would show that those conditions would render the project uneconomic, and that would have put the burden back on the board to make a decision as to whether those conditions had to be in the decision anyway. That's the point in the hearing when the board gets to see economic information from the applicant. It's after it's gone through peer review. The board has come up with a set of conditions that it thinks it's going to impose, and then the applicant gets to object on the grounds of economics. The applicant didn't do that in this case, which I think procedurally means that it's stated that it can live with a requirement of a loading zone within the project site, and it can live with a 1.25 parking space ratio. Although some of those are compacted, that begs some different questions.
Mm-hmm.
But so it is, by saying that it, I think, can live with those conditions and foregoing the opportunity to present a pro forma that on the grounds that those conditions would have sunk the project, the applicant's now essentially lost that opportunity, and we can proceed on the assumption that the economics of their project are such that they can live with those two things. But DHCD's regulations that we're operating under for the purposes of this hearing say that that's the only time when the ZBA can ask for a pro forma, generally the only time when an applicant can ask for a pro forma from the applicant. So if it's not objecting to conditions that we're going to impose, then it doesn't have to provide that kind of economic information. The board generally is required by those regulations to impose whatever conditions it thinks are in the public interest, but until you get to that point where you're imposing a condition in the applicant box, that's really the only time when the pro formas come into play.
Thank you. John, did you have anything else to add at this time?
Not at this point, no.
Okay. Eric?
The whole time we've been talking about how there's too much density and not enough parking. The applicant has now reduced the density and increased the parking, which is what we've been asking for all along. I think that conceptually that's a pretty good thing, but I don't know that we can just infer that the peer reviews would be favorable because what they've done, we believe, is favorable. I think you'd actually have to see how the mechanics of this plan, and I realize you haven't had a chance to review it, so I'm looking forward to hearing about the plan, but I would want to see what the peer consultants had to say about it, if they had any concerns, suggestions about that, and so as a result, I would be looking to see if you guys would grant an extension, just so that we can get that new information in. Obviously, if tonight's the cutoff, we will never hear from our peer consultants on that. That's all I have to say.
Thank you, Eric. Kathy?
Agreed, I don't have a whole lot to add. I think I am a little frustrated as well. You're asking us to move and make decisions, but then providing us with documentation, you know, a day or two ahead of time, which is technical and, you know, at times you want to take the time to review it. And as a member of the ZBA, I think we owe it to the residents of the town to make an informed decision. And we want to welcome this development, make it work for the town, but it's hard to make an informed decision when you're just presented with information not too far before the hearing. And I myself am not a traffic expert, so I would like some feedback from someone that is. And I'm sure the residents of the neighborhood would like to see that as well. So other than that, I don't have a lot to add, but thank you.
Thank you. Si?
Well, I've rendered some comment on this subject matter before, and I feel like I have to do it again tonight. And I pretty much support a lot of the commentary that's gone on already, so I won't try to dwell on any of that much more. It's been almost a year since we started this process, and I must say that if I take a look at what's being proposed on the table right now tonight, vis-a-vis what was there on the table on February 4th, I really, personally, don't think much progress has been made. Many of the core issues that have been brought up during the course of the year, I think, have been very modestly addressed, and or still work in progress. And density has changed, I agree with that, in the right direction. But if I look at it on balance, I see the facility is still dense. And the parking and the loading, unloading issues are still work in progress, and the impacts of whatever comes out of that on every a lot of few other things is still in progress. I noticed in one of your recent letters that was submitted to the town since, I think within the past week, there's been comparison to other 40B projects in the general area of Reading. But what I see as a differential between those projects and this project is this is in a truly residential district, whereas those are in business districts of one sort or another. The developer has also indicated that any further changes to the project, as is currently on the table, would result in a loss of units or a reduction in the leasable square footage would make the project more uneconomic. Didn't say it would be uneconomic, it said it would be more uneconomic, which means something smaller could still be economic. It raises the issue of what is economic and what becomes uneconomic, and I think that needs to be substantiated, in my view, somewhere along the way. I heard what council just said, but we need to quantify that and independently review that process somewhere before we get to the end of the line. The divide that exists between the community and the proposed development as it exists today, I think, is still wide. One of the abutters, I think, in the last week wrote a very interesting summary of what his views were. And he was very sensitive to what's been done and the marginal improvements or changes that have been made. And he's still concerned about the people in the community that are going to be abutting and living next to this facility. And he was suggesting a very bold additional change in size. We need finality on these issues that we put on the table this evening, and we're not there. We're not there. So we need more time to really, truly address this. And if we have to act tonight, then we have to act tonight. But I'm not sure the outcome would be very good. I'll just leave it at that for the time being. I'm sure we'll get into some detailed discussion on some of the items later on.
Thanks, Si. Nick?
I pretty much echo what most of the other members have said about this project. My pressing concern right now is, given that the public hearing portion of this is closing, I'm wondering how that affects the ability for the applicant to submit new information and still have the public respond. For example, if the board does have a concern that does require new information for the applicant, I don't know how that would be dealt with, and it leads me to believe that that would just be left to being put into the conditions without really getting any information from the applicant about it. So I guess that might be a question for town council, but my other concern is going back to parking. While I do feel I'm a little bit more comfortable with the ratio than the rest of the members, one thing that I'm still seeking from the applicant is what happens if there is an overflow of parking. I haven't seen a parking management plan or any way to address, you know, what would happen given the limited spaces if there is more demand than is available. That's really all I have.
I'd like to have town council chime in on your question, Nick, please.
Two points in response to your question, I think. One, yes, technically, if the hearing is closed, the applicant can't provide any more information, and the members of the public can't provide any more information. The board can keep meeting and keep discussing the application amongst itself, but in terms of the factual information that it's using to have that discussion, it's limited to what has been submitted thus far. I just want to raise the point that if the hearing is closed and we can't take in any more information, the board still does retain some power to force project changes on the applicant through the form of conditions. In other words, you are not limited to a yes or no vote on the most recent plan for you. If there are things that about that plan that the board wants changed, it can force that through conditions in the decision that it issues. It can't take in a new plan that shows those changes on the page, but there is some ability to affect project changes even after the public hearing is closed if the board so desires.
Thanks.
Anything else, Nick?
That's it.
All right, the applicant has been waiting patiently with bated breath, I'm sure, to start and continue and respond to their part of the presentation, so I'll open the floor up to the applicant.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Matthew Zucker from MKM Ready. Good evening, the board, and the public kind of staff. What I had prepared is kind of off the table with a lot of the comments I heard, so I'll just get right into some of these. One, the hearing, if it closes tonight, as town council will say, it's a close of the hearing, it's not a vote tonight. But two, and most importantly, we've made, one, the 40B process and the law is a challenging law. It is not perfect, we all know that. I sit on the board, it presents challenges for the board, it challenges for us, and this process hasn't been perfect. We were committed from the beginning to working with the board, and we remain committed to working with it. Because we get plans maybe a day or two or last minute, it's only because we're working back and forth to try to address a comment we heard from the board, from the public, from our own peer. So we are always going back and forth. The really only change we made since the last meeting, the biggest change, was the parking plan. So we were at the last meeting, the board took a straw vote, they basically said we wouldn't, 1.25 we wouldn't consider if it, like it's one. We still believe one could be more appropriate, but we heard that from the board. We also heard about the loading zone. So we went back and said, neither can we meet that, or is that going to be uneconomic? So we spent a huge amount of time trying to see how we could maybe get closer to 1.25, maybe even get to 1.25, and how we could get a loading zone. I spent a lot of time with the engineer going over the plans, and the biggest change we made was submitting a plan a week ago on the new parking layout that showed 86 spaces. At least that got us to the 1.25 parking ratio. Then we looked at, so that was submitted a week ago, and then we started looking at ways we could look at the loading zone more specifically. We already had a plan that showed one space in front of the building. The peer reviewer didn't really like it there, we really didn't like it there, it was right in front of the building, but it did fit. So then we started looking at other spaces, maybe something in the building that could be dual use. It was more, let's just put some options together, see if any of the options is something that the board could accept and that we can live with. And then we also have one which we believe is the best solution, is putting one on the Lincoln Street side. So we've been going back and forth with town staff, getting comments from people, and we get questions from them, we respond. So it's a continuous flow of information back and forth with town staff. So because we're still submitting stuff today, some of that is just in response to, hey, this number's not right, or we got this from the town engineer. So we are working hard to try to take the comments we've heard about parking. 1.0 isn't right. We submitted information that 1.0 is the trend. Recently, we even submitted that four local towns, similar towns, have all put their parking ratios, their commuter rails, from 0.75 to some ratio where if you're in 2,000 feet, it's one thing, 1,000 feet, it's another. So we're constantly looking at those. But we heard what the board said. They wanted 1.25. So we went back to the drawing board. We revised the plan to show 1.25. The plan, nothing else changed. We, revising all the interior architectural layouts is a time-consuming and costly thing, not knowing, what the board was going to act on. So these plans under the 40B law are still preliminary plans. Final plans have to conform with the decision. Town council is well-versed enough in the 40B to know if there's a condition and it's not something you appeal to HAC because it's uneconomic, and it has to get incorporated into a final plan. It has to get reviewed by town engineers, the building department, CPD staff. I mean, it is a process to make sure that the plans conform. So for instance, at the last meeting, if you denied our waiver for a 1.0 and issued a condition that it be 1.25, this plan was in response and would have to get reviewed by town engineer to make sure it works properly. These plans are prepared with auto turn and everything, so they work. And it's a process of making sure everything conforms. Also, some of this stuff is somewhat out of the purview of, say, what would be a local concern in terms of some of it's, maybe some of those spaces are, more challenging than others to get into, but they still work. And, again, town council there's case law in HAC about internal parking layouts. So the thing is, the drive aisles were important safety, the stop signs by the drive aisles, doing all of that. I know it's frustrating when you were getting information up to the last minute, but it's because we're still working on making sure these things work. We couldn't submit a plan that the parking didn't work. I mean, then it doesn't work. So it takes a lot of time with our subcontractors and our engineers and our architects to kind of get a plan. The landscape architect, we just changed that plan recently because he was showing a 6-foot high fence, but we wanted to increase that to 8-foot. So we just got that plan from him yesterday, and I submitted it right away. So because I had a plan that was 6 feet. So I know the process isn't perfect. Like, it's even seeing now, I would like to have all the spaces numbered on the plan, but the engineer couldn't get to it. So it's not a perfect process. These plans are by no means where they will be if they get, when you get to the design development drawings and CDs, they really are still preliminary plans, and that's kind of part of the 40B process. So again, if we addressed what we thought were, there was a straw vote taken at the last meeting. Two of the big issues were parking ratio and the loading zone. So we worked hard to address those two issues. We think that this information works, and it still has to get worked through final plans with the town engineer. We're comfortable it works, and we committed to work with the board. We didn't just say one's the number and we'll see you go to HAC, and we'll, it's uneconomic, and then it has to be a local concern that outweighs the need for affordable housing. We'd much rather work with the board, but at this point, I believe we've responded to the two major concerns. While there's still always other issues, but the two major condition concerns are to the 40B that the board addressed last time. So that's kind of where we are. We actually have our contractor here tonight. So many construction management plans, Matt Rosehammer from Ball Hill Builders. So he's very well versed in building on compact sites like this. So he's here to answer any questions. And we're happy to address any questions, but we feel like we've updated the waiver list. We have a plan that shows a 1.25 ratio. We have plans that show some different options for loading zones. While we still don't think one is necessary, and can point to a number of HAC cases where it's not necessary. We do think there's a benefit, and we've listened to the board saying you should have one. So I'm not sure what more information we could provide to you, but we're certainly willing to listen to see what the board's comments are. So that's it for now. I'm sure we'll
Great.
Have some additional thoughts.
Thank you. You know, I understand your position on a number of matters that you raised. You know, I think the frustration is, and we understand that you're working on things up to the last minute, but you set a plan in today and you got feedback on it today. You know, last time we met that was, and I understand you have vendors to deal with. I understand you have lead times that you need, but don't put it back on the town that you would, you know, we asked you for changes today. It's because we got the plan today. We reviewed it today, town staff, and we got it back to you today. So let's call it what it is and make sure that we're clear for the record that the information that's submitted last minute only puts more pressure on town staff, who's done a remarkable job to turn around those things in a timely fashion. We appreciate your willingness to work, but I think my opinion is that some of these new items, and we certainly appreciate your willingness to work with us, create questions in my mind that I'm not qualified to answer. And I think, you know, particularly peer review regarding the two changes that you made to the parking waivers and to the loading space waiver. I mean, are we pretty satisfied right now that we're not talking about parking and we're not talking about a loading zone on the street anymore? We're talking about a loading zone on site?
We're still committed. I think there's a condition in there of working with the town. We still feel strongly that the best space would be in front of the building, but that's the story for another day. That's why we put one. Town staff has been more than great to work with, and we did submit that parking plan a week ago. So we're, you know, it's not a lot of time. Everything we've said, they've been great to respond to. The loading zone thing we've been working on, again, we don't feel strongly that one isn't needed or would be required under HAC regulations, but we're trying to come to a compromise on where one could be. And of course it does present other, you know, when you do that, it presents another question that needs to get answered. There's no doubt about that. But, you know, at some point, that was more of a compromise based on a straw poll that was taken to try to come up with a solution. And it doesn't mean it's a perfect solution, and it doesn't mean we're completely happy with it. It may not be the board's completely happy with it. But, it, you know, if there wasn't a local concern that outweighs the need for affordable housing, it's probably something that could pass muster. We think that having it there is the best space. The compact spaces, and, you know, I know it's 30 Haven, if nobody wants to see it, but they have 25%, I mean, they have 33% compact spaces in the building. And they actually have, there was a report, they have units that actually don't own cars either. There was a report on smart growth projects, and Reading was one of them at some point. At some point, there was a study done. But they have 33% compact spaces in their building. So it's a kind of standard under smart growth principles is 30% spaces in a smart growth project can be compact. Compact spaces are usually 8x16. We made ours 8.5x16. So, you know, we understand that's another set of issues, but it's not something that's uncommon in projects like this either.
All right, thanks. In response to your commentary, I think it's appropriate that I read a memo received today from the town manager on behalf of the chairman of the Board of Selectmen dated today regarding Reading Village comprehensive permit application loading zone addressed to me as chair. I'd like to make sure it's part of the record and that I read it into the record. As you know, MKM Reading LLC, MKM, has raised the idea of establishing a loading zone located within the public right-of-way on Lincoln Street as part of the Reading Village 40B rental housing development. MKM appeared before the Board of Selectmen on November 15, 2016 and had a discussion of the proposed loading zone. However, a detailed plan for the loading zone was not provided. MKM agreed to follow up with such a plan, but to date, we have not received anything. The Board of Selectmen has received public comment, which was exclusively in opposition to locating a loading zone in the public right-of-way on Lincoln Street. At the November 29th, 2016 Board of Selectmen meeting, I was asked by my fellow board members to write a letter to the ZBA indicating the loading zone has been tabled by the Board of Selectmen due to a lack of information. I just thought it was pertinent that we read that into the record regarding, you know, foray into the world of the Reading Board of Selectmen regarding the loading zone. I'm inclined to open the meeting up to public comment. Do you have some comments before I do that, John?
I have one. I have two questions for okay. Town Council.
One question.
Tell me about 40 days. 40 days is 40 calendar days, or is it 40 working days, or?
40 calendar days.
40 calendar days.
By my calculation, if we closed tonight, the deadline for rendering a decision would be January 24th.
So the board could be working.
And then, so 40 days to render a decision, and then there's an additional 14 days after that to file the written decision with the town clerk.
Okay. The other question is relative to if this were to end tonight, we would close the public hearing. The board submits its decision with the conditions. Then hands it back to the applicant. The applicant evaluates and decides what he wants to do, if he wants to go to mass housing or if he's going to accept it and move forward. Subsequent to that, changes always in a project like this occur. The question is, how do those changes get taken care of? I want to see two avenues. One is that it immediately comes back to the Zoning Board of Appeals, which happens to be a public hearing again. It would have to be specifically designated in the decision how that is to be handled.
It could be spelled out in the decision, but there's also this is also governed by DHED's regulations.
I don't know what that regulation.
And you're right that it's certainly not uncommon after going through the pains of issuing a decision for the applicant to come back in and seek some changes 6 months or a year down the road. The way it works is that they submit a letter detailing their proposed changes to the project. The board then has a limited amount of time to determine whether those changes are substantial or insubstantial. And there's a couple examples of substantial versus insubstantial in the regulations, and there's case law on it as well. So we could have a pretty good idea. We could likely have a pretty good idea once we get the letter whether it's big or not. If it is insubstantial, the board could make that determination at a meeting, not a public hearing, just a regular board meeting. And those changes are then magically deemed part of the comprehensive permit without any further action. If the changes are substantial, all you have to do is declare them to be substantial, and then you notice a brand new public hearing, and we're back with the full board public hearing applicant here to evaluate those changes. Now, if it comes to that, it's a full-blown public hearing, but it's limited to the scope of that hearing is limited to the changes that they've made. You're not going back, assuming you know you've approved it in the first place. You're not going back and revisiting every aspect of the project all over again. You're just evaluating whether the changes are okay or not.
Thank you. Gene, did you want to ask something? Please.
I just want to bring a couple of points up about the loading zone and the parking, because that seems to be two of the biggest issues that are before the board. This plan that's up here on the screen, we received at 3 o'clock this afternoon with the loading zone on the side of the building, as it's shown. The plan relocates the transformer to the rear corner. If that plan is in the parking spaces are occupied, and RMLD needs to gain access to that transformer the way it's shown on this plan. I don't know how they would be able to do that. I don't know if it's a problem or it isn't a problem. But RMLD's opinion on the transformer, I think, is important to really have this be a viable alternative. And since we only got it at 3 o'clock, I think it's fair to say that there isn't enough time. And in fairness to RMLD, I mean, I wouldn't expect that kind of immediate response. So that's just something I want to raise with regard to that alternative. In terms of the parking, and I know we've talked about it a lot, I think we know how congested this area is and how many cars are already clogging the streets. Overflow parking is something that has been discussed, but we really don't have a solution on the table right now. And I think that's an important thing to keep in mind of all the issues, whether the ratio is the right ratio or the wrong ratio. It's the overflow parking and the fact that you're in a congested area. Where are those cars going to go? So those are just the key points that I wanted to make. Thank you.
Thanks, Gene.
David, I was asking Gene another question.
Yep.
Gene, under the proposed list of waivers on their number 12, it appears that the Department of Public Works would have to issue a permit to increase the entrance off of Lincoln Street from 24 feet to 41 feet. And that was just received today, which I assume it was.
Yes, it was.
We haven't had any time to do that. Would that add another problem to our...
That would have to go before the Board of Selectmen as the roadway commissioners.
I was just going to ask you that.
Yep.
Does that, okay. So there's two major issues that we just found out today that we need to address.
Thanks, John. All right. I think I'm going to open up the hearing now to... I'm sorry. Did you have something you want to add?
Thanks. I just want to modify one thing I said.
Right.
We did receive the plan on Monday. The plan I was looking at, we received at 3 o'clock, had a few more changes. But that transformer was there on Monday. So
okay.
It's been a couple of days, but I still think it's a relatively new change.
Okay. We discussed that a little bit in initial comments as well regarding that being perhaps a concern. Okay, I think it's appropriate now to open the hearing up to public comment. If you'd like to speak on the matters that have been discussed tonight, please wait to be recognized by the chair. Address your comments to the board, please. Identify yourself by name and address so that we have your name for the record, and we're happy to hear from you. Anybody like to speak? Anybody else have any comment? Yes, sir.
Nick Gardner, 76 Washington Street. Sorry for the last few days. And so first, I'd be curious to know how we got from what should be four loading zones to only one. Because I was here at every single meeting, and I don't recall hearing clearly from the board the rationale why they were comfortable with downsizing that requirement from four to one for a complex that big with that many units. And the other comments I have is, when the applicant says that they've addressed all of their concerns regarding parking and loading zones, I find that a bit unfair when those changes have other impacts on the project that needs to be taken into consideration. So snow removal and management has not been mentioned tonight. There's way less space than there used to be given the reduction in the landscaping, so where are they going to put that snow? When there's 86 cars parked there and there's a big snowstorm, how will a tow truck or a value truck be able to navigate this and remove the snow? And then the last point I'll make is that the impact on the neighbors, the abutters, there's now no screening whatsoever for the neighbors. There used to be a tiny little bank of greenery on the southern border of the property. Now there's nothing.
Thank you for your comments.
Yes.
Mary Ann Downey, 13 Heather Drive. I have a question for the board about understanding the waiver requirement for lot coverage. Is the lot coverage requirement, I think my problem here is 9, is that include impervious surfaces or just the buildings?
Just the buildings.
So that's how they come up with 57%? Is it, if you included the impervious, it's like, it's not the same as open space because there's probably like 20% open space on the site. And so just related to that and that gentleman's comment about snow, if the transformer is there, I mean, that's like in a key snow storage area. You can't cover a transformer with snow. And snow has to go somewhere. So I would just support the board asking for, I don't know, can you ask for less than 30-day extension? I mean, some kind of extension to have RMLD address that, because that seems like that's a pretty serious thing. How could they maintain that transformer? How would a truck get near it? Even if a car isn't there, I mean, the garage won't. I mean, I just don't understand how it would get there. Thank you.
Anybody else from the public? Yes, ma'am.
15 Los 52 Washington Street. I have some budget, so if you have anything there. I did notice in paperwork today that it mentions the hours that the trash cannot be on Prescott Street. And I believe the plan is that the trash is going to be on Winston Street. So I would like it to be clear what hours the trash is not to be on Prescott or Lincoln Street. And there are also some sort of agreements or assurances from the developer about trash removal and various other things. And just given the history of working with the developer, I don't want those, you know, a wink and a smile and a handshake. I would really like those firmed down and in writing about what their plans are, in specific with trash removal. I think the snow removal is another one that we can't just go with what they're saying is going to happen. I'm not sure that the loading zone is completely on the property. I'm just looking at a map of it. It looks like it butts a little bit into the street. So I just, I know that these are just rough architectural lines, but I do think that warrants some consideration to making sure that it's actually the whole loading zone is on the property. And I am very concerned about the loading zone. I live in the area, and I just know how often there are two mail trucks parking in front of my house, and that's, you're having 60 units here, you're going to have at least a mail truck there all day long. And various drop-off pickup vehicles. So I think we shouldn't underestimate how little parking there is in this area. And to compare this to Third Haven, whenever I go to Third Haven, there are 2-hour spots. So it's, you know, you can't say that these are further before I can help. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments from the public? Yes, sir.
Nick Aiello, I own 9294 Washington Street, which is one of the, in the back of the project, it abuts the project. I know when the corner lot was purchased, there was a hope that there would be more buffering between those houses that are back there. And I did heard mention of an 8-foot fence. Is that the new plan instead of, I don't know Rick, if there's how much greenery is planned or what the landscape plan is or how that's changed. That's.
Any other comment? Yes.
I just wanted to ask one more thing. Is there precedent in this town for granting 30% compact spots to any other developments or any percent of compact? And how as can you manage it? How do you enforce that? Do you deed certain units compact spots? Like, how do people know? Do the people with the bigger cars fight for the bigger spots? Is it like downtown where they're compact but you could wedge a bigger vehicle in? I don't really know how it works in practice.
There's a couple of points that they brought that I'd like to address. So one, on the compacts, as I said, 30 Haven has a similar, it's 33% compacts, but it is a management, there is a level of management that goes. I mean, you could pull into like any of the hospitals now and see an SUV wedged into a compact space. But so there is that when you rent out a space, it's specifically to, you have to register a car with that space.
So you have a sign
so,
spot?
So we're going to do what we plan on doing, and it's not, you know, obviously there's going to be at least one space per unit. We thought of maybe if you didn't rent the space, there's a reduction in your rent or something like that. And then for people who wanted to, there was some, and we'd like to, and some dedicated for just visitor, I think would be the appropriate condition that there's so many, I think town council maybe could draft something up, but that there's, whether it's 4 or 6 or 2 or 10, whatever, there's an appropriate number of dedicated visitor spaces. There's actually, when you pull in, and just figuring out there's some spaces here that tend themselves well when you pull into visitor spaces. There's a couple other points that we brought up. The snow removals are good points. It's a management thing, but we'd be fine with it. I mean, at some point, it has to be brought off site. We don't have a huge amount here. Obviously, you have a bad winter, and you're going to be trucking it off site. It's part of a management cost that's very common in buildings that you are trucking it off site. We're not piling it up spaces, so we're fine with a condition that we have to, truck it off site. It's an extra cost, but it's part of management of a building like this. There was another, the fence, getting to that 1.25 ratio and a number of units that we could compromise with. We did lose some of that green space. There was ended up being a couple percent reduction in that, say, coverage that included pervious from before. So we decided to propose, and there's a small piece there before where the plants were going to grow too tall because you can't put a big root ball in there. So to make up for what would be maybe the plants grew to 8 feet instead of 6 feet, we would propose an 8-foot fence back there along that line here. And a couple other points. The original buildings on that site have a 0.4 front yard setback, a 1.5 setback on the sides, and a 0 setback on the rear. 0. And when we originally started, our numbers were front was 1.5, side was 3.0, and rear was 5.6. We're now at a front of 5.8. a side of 15.7, and a rear of 12.2 to over 20. So there's been huge improvements in the setbacks of this building. It may not be perfect where everyone wants, but that is huge improvement, and huge over what is there now, where you virtually have zero setback, and in fact, some of those buildings are probably encroaching upon the street there now. So we did hear comments from the beginning about snow and falling off the roof, so we pulled those buildings back a little from the street. So now you have that, and then the sidewalk, certainly you could have pushed those back up and created some more buffer in the back, but we're trying to reach a happy medium of where those setbacks are. But the setbacks to the building have increased a great deal, and we're tentative to the impact. So Lighting in the back is minimal. There's no lumens on neighboring properties, and we're really limiting the lighting on the site, especially on the back. There's still lighting that has to get worked out on like the front, and the signage still is an open issue, but we have to comply with those bylaws. But as I would say in a draft decision, there's a operation management plan that has to be submitted, reviewed with the town staff, and given every year. There's also conditions on updating town staff on usage of parking at the 60, 80, and 100% lease-up to determine if maybe a zip car would be more suited there, or there's some alternative that you could work with town staff to address. And for overflow parking, I drove by there on my way here tonight, 6 o'clock. Those lots around there were probably 70% open. For most of the year, you could park there, and you could park there overnight. You're not allowed to park in the winter, but they're really only enforced during snowstorms. We've talked to DPW, we've talked to police. So there are times of the year from 1 a.m. to 6 a.m. you can't park there. But if you had people coming to visit you for dinner at 6 o'clock on the night, there's abundance of parking around there. I mean, it's busy during the day, and there's sometimes a space or two that people come and go. So it's never close to 100%, but once 5-4 starts coming, it just like in the morning. So tonight, if you had 10 people over for dinner at your house, there was plenty of parking within a walkable distance, literally across the street, but then even looking bigger. So that's how we manage will overflow, is that some people are going to inevitably park in a space at night there, because most often you're having people visit at night. But also a condition was there that we would continue to work with the town and with private properties to maybe identify, and maybe there is a better use of the town to use some of those spaces downtown. But that's a process that we would use our best efforts to work with as we would move forward. So I hope I addressed a couple comments.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman,
sure.
If public comment is done, if I could request maybe a 5 to 10 minute break to confer with my client on a couple of things before we continue the discussion, would
sure.
that be appropriate?
Yeah, let me find out if
there's
any
sorry,
public,
I thought
public
we,
comment
I apologize.
First, and then
okay.
based upon that, we can entertain a suggestion. Are there any more comments from the public? Hearing none, we'll go ahead and close the public comment portion of the hearing. The applicant has requested a brief recess, which we'll find a grant.
Okay.
And we'll go off the record for 5 minutes,
yeah.
10 minutes.
Yeah, that, we don't need any more time.
10 minutes?
That's great. Right.
Sure. 5 minutes.
out of recess. Is there anything that arose during the discussion that you'd like to have on the record, or?
Mr. Chairman, we would appreciate it for the record. Jeff Angler from FTD LLC. Clearly, we understand the board and town staff have expressed disappointment, concern, what have you, about when the plan was submitted, not having enough time, not having them peer reviewed. We talked internally. I think our inclination at this point, first, I would say the characterization of the scope of changes, I think, is a bit exaggerated. I don't think a new traffic analysis needs to be done. The points of egress have not changed. The density has been reduced. The number of people have not changed. It's just more cars. That's not going to necessitate, or more parking, no more trips. So from our perspective, it does not need to be reopened for the traffic peer review. However, if you want to have a traffic consultant look at the parking configuration, do the spots work? You know, are peak cars a lot able to pull in and out? Likewise, the loading zone. So our inclination, or our offer, if you will, is to work with the board and discuss leaving the public portion of this process open to allow the board to have time both personally to review the plans, to have a peer reviewer look at the parking configuration and the loading zone. We're comfortable with the condition in the permit that says the transformer location is conditional on the approval of the power company. We're quite confident it's going to work, but write that into the condition, because ultimately they're the ones that need to be comfortable that it's at a location that works. And then we would ask, I mean, I think the board's aware, but there's been a draft decision prepared, which I don't think is that far off from a final decision. So what we would ask in return is that if the public hearing process remains open, that 40-day period gets truncated down, and thus, instead of having an extension and then 40 days, we leave the public comment period open, and that time, which frankly I don't think you need 40 days based on what I've seen and the limit of issues we're talking about, between when the public comment or the public hearing process closes and the decision, the formal written decision, needs to be issued. So hopefully that was not too convoluted. Probably was, but that is kind of, you know, what we're thinking in order to satisfy the two big issues that were mentioned last time and seem to remain, are the parking and the loading. We want you comfortable and having your professional to look at that. But at the same time, concurrent to that, we would ask the board to review the plans, review the draft decision, so that process is not limited exclusively to the review of those two issues. And then we reconvene, we talk about it, and I would think the written decision is pretty much, you know, close to being done at that point in time. So, but you would still have a little time on the back end if there's, your town council needs some time to clean up a few written items.
All right, I think I'm gonna repeat back and add to, I think, what you just said. Right?
Okay.
Thank you for those considerations. I think engineering peer review, traffic peer review, I think we want either to receive from you and perhaps work on between now and whenever we reconvene again, a traffic management plan regarding the 85 spaces, so that we have some confidence that you're going to police those properly. Town council can work with you on that. You can send something over to town council. You know, certainly that's a workable solution. In terms of, you know, we'd also want to have somebody review the new loading zone, and I think you're right. You know, and at least we're in agreement on several things, and that is that the board does appreciate you recognizing that we need a little bit more time with this. My only concern with that is we're approaching the holiday season, and I don't think anything's gonna. So we're looking at the remainder of the year. Nothing's gonna get done. Let's not. Hope springs eternal.
Sure.
But I don't think we're gonna get any meaningful peer review, and I agree with you. I don't think it's an enormous amount of review that needs to be done here. So I imagine that, you know, perhaps we consider a continuation into January. I think we've got the 19th open right now. In terms of, so that's certainly up for consideration discussion. And I think it's, I don't think it's unreasonable given that while it's a 30 calendar-ish day extension, it's really only a you know, 2.5 weeks if you take into consideration that we're talking, you know, from after the new year forward to really get any meaningful work product back or meaningful dialogue. I mean, I'm sure you want to shut it down a little bit too or celebrate. And then the only other comment that I have is, you know, I would certainly defer to town council with regard to commentary regarding the reduction of the 40-day period from that date. You know, I don't want to tie anybody's hands in terms of having enough time, both from town council and town staff and board members, should we decide that additional time to convene during that 40-day period might be necessary. We may very well be right that we're close, but until we see, have all the information, we won't know whether or not we need one more meeting or two more meetings. Or, and so, you know, I'd be interested, I think, Chris, in hearing your thoughts, given that, you know, a lot of this is perhaps going to fall into your lap a little bit and see what you think about that.
Thank you. Two things. I appreciate the applicant's willingness to agree to some extra time to have give the board the ability to review the changes to the plans. And I also think we are in a pretty good position with respect to where the decision currently sits compared to other 40B hearings I've been involved in. But that being said, the 40-day window of time for the board to deliberate after the close of the public hearing does serve a useful function. And I think the board absolutely does need a measure of time after the close of the public hearing to review the decision and talk amongst itself and revise the decision after it's clear that no more information is coming. Really digest what is in front of it and drill down into conditions. So I am sensitive to the fact that if we get more time on the front end to keep the public hearing open, maybe we don't need 40 days, but we need a good window of time to do for the board to do with business and for myself and Gene and Julie to work on the decision offline. So I appreciate the offer as it was presented. I think 40 days is not enough to keep the public hearing open and render a final decision. But if we were to go from 40 to 30 on the time to deliberate and work on the decision, I think that might be doable where we're at. But again, I think we need to protect the deliberation period for purposes of getting that decision in final shape. And the board does need its time to deliver the hearing process.
All right. Is somebody counting on their fingers and toes? We are 40 days after the 19th puts us, or 30 days after the 19th puts us. In the meantime, Gene, I'm just picking on you because I see your calendar's open. How do board members feel about it? So I think we appreciate. Well, let me give you a second. Right. Give me a second. I'd appreciate also, we'll let the applicant chime in, but also before we offer up any compromise, I'd like to hear what the board members think about it. That said, go ahead.
Listen, your town council is about the nicest town council I've ever worked with. It's eminently reasonable, but I'm having a hard time understanding the need for the, I've seen the draft decision, it's close to being final. I don't understand why over the next 30 days it cannot be circulated to the board. Comments can be provided back. 95% of the conditions or items will not change. We have two or three remaining items. So if something out of the loading zone or parking needs to be rewritten into the decision, I mean, that's a very small amount of work, right? So the decision is, from my perspective, can be easily done by the close of the public hearing, and then you have a little bit of time if there's some surprise or something else. I mean, I understand legally from the close of the public hearing, you have an amount of time to write the written decision. I've seen other boards, it happens simultaneously. They have a decision ready, when the public hearing closes, they vote it, and 2 days later, it's stamped at the town clerk's office. I think something like where no new information is being submitted. I mean, granted, we've received a lot of criticism about it coming in late, but what you have is now what's being submitted. So you don't have to worry about new stuff coming in. It just needs to be reviewed. The board needs to look at the condition. You'll have 3 weeks after the holidays to look at a permit that's not that dense. I don't see why another 30 or 40 days after the 19th is necessary, considering we're giving another 30-day extension.
I appreciate that.
I think we can create a draft plan.
New information will be coming into the record. It won't be from you guys. It'll be from the peer reviewer. And we can assume it is likely that the peer reviewer may not find anything radically wrong with your new plans. But I don't know that the board can assume that. The board needs to assume that the decision may need to change in response to whatever it is that we hear from in the next round, and can't be in a position of getting a peer review report submitted in advance of the 19th or on the 19th, and then needing to render a final written decision a matter of days after that.
So let me make a suggestion. Certainly, I recognize you, but based upon what he said, what you said, what we've had to say, does it make sense to reconvene on the 19th and presuming all things being equal, we're ready to, you know, we don't see that an enormous amount of time is needed following that, have a discussion on the 19th regarding shortening the period? Let's just suggest for a minute that new information comes in and, you know, we still have things to discuss in the 90s. I'm just using this.
Sure. No, I love theoreticals.
All right. Okay. You know, why can't we have a discussion on that date as to what comfort level the board, the town council, town staff, and the applicant has regarding how long we'll need to deliberate further?
Yeah, but by that time, we can't, by that point, we can't, we don't have the legal authority on the 19th if we give you an extension to the 19th to say you're not entitled to the 40 days. So you guys can say, you know, screw you, you know, we're taking the 40 days. Here's my theoretical to you. Let's say, first of all, I think the peer review you're gonna get back is like a 2 or 3 page document, if that. And let's just say it is. And let's just say, you know, the parking ratio as designed, there's a couple of options. Parking as designed works, all right, we're at 1.25. Let's say they say 4 or 5 spaces don't work, all right, we're now down under 1.25. The board can either say, all right, you're close, you're at 1.2, and condition it as such. You can condition it as such that, well, you're going to have to figure out how to get to 1.25, and in which case my client will have a choice to make. How do we do that? Do we reduce the density? We find other spaces, or do we have a problem? So, I mean, I think we're talking about 2 or 3 issues that can all be discussed on the 19th. It's not like we're going to be talking about 30 different things. So, to me, you're talking about 2 or 3 conditions, which, back to my original point, everything else will already be reviewed by the board and by town council, and it's just a matter of dropping in what you guys are going to determine on the 19th, that these are the things that we have to have or we don't have to have. So that's my, you know, I don't know if my client has a different take, but I just don't see the need to elongate the process when we're going to be talking pretty much parking ratio or loading zone. From our perspective, nothing else needs to be discussed.
Okay. we're all going into this with the best of intentions and understanding that we all have timelines that we want to meet, have to meet, are obligated to meet, and I think we're all trying to find a fair compromise. I would suggest perhaps if we're going to get it done right now, does 30 days give us enough time from the 19th?
I could live with keeping the public hearing open until the 19th and then allowing the board 30 days to...
Can we get there?
All right. Can I back up one quick step because I have a question?
Sure.
At the last hearing, we took a vote on the waivers then to see where we were at with all the board, and we got down to a strong belief that 1.25 below that wasn't going to be approved, and that at least one, if not more, there was a need for a loading zone. So, based on these plans, I'm just trying to see where the board is going. The making sure the parking layout works, I understand it. I mean, from our point, it's actually more important for it to work for us, because then we have a viable project. And I know it works. I mean, there's always, I've seen the town's peer reviewer do turning radius plans, and I've seen ours that will show it work. And the loading zone, you know, to look at. I'm just not sure, is there something else more the board is looking? Because for the traffic engineer to look at these plans, it's literally you ask for a turning radius plan to show how cars pull in and out of maybe the tougher spaces to prove that they work. I saw one that Green did just the other day that showed that on shorter drive aisles. So is there something else we're missing here? Because that, is there, I just, you know, we're talking about an extension where the two issues could also be conditioned out, that it has to be 1.25, it has to work, it has to meet, town engineer has to sign off on it that it works, and the loading zone has to be approved, and if they're not, and there's also provisions in there, like just like the building department, if there's peer review on the review of the complete plans, we pay for that, and we have to work with them to make sure they do work. So say they didn't work, we'd have to make a decision then, because we have a decision that final plans have to comply with. So I'm just not sure what other information, is it just those two, or is there other stuff you're looking for from us for?
Yeah, I think we have an obligation to review the overall decision, plans, waivers, and so now I'm gonna give you an example that you gave us. We're volunteers. You know that you serve on a volunteer board, and we have people that owe us deliverables as well. Just like you have vendors that owe you deliverables. And sometimes they don't get those deliverables till you get to the last second. And you know, while we're scrambling to get those deliverables. You know, just like you couldn't give us really a definite time when you were going to have things and you got them when you got them, you know, and it is what it is, we may be facing that same challenge. And so while we're sensitive to the fact that you want this to be, you know, you want finality, the board and the town want finality. And I think all we're talking about here is, you know, a few days to make sure that the volunteer board and the town government have enough time to gather information and then meet as a volunteer, gather information from its vendors, and your vendors, and its vendors, to be able to vet the issues that we were just presented with. And then, you know, we're a talkative board. You see how we operate. You know, I don't want to deprive members of the board opportunities to meet if the board feels it's necessary to have a discussion about it. We want to get this right, just like you want to get it right. And so I don't think, we appreciate the reasonableness you're showing, we appreciate your concern, and you know, your questions are well taken. You know, I think we just need to be sure that we're getting it right, that you got it right. I don't have a particular qualification in some of those areas to do that. I don't think any of the other board members do either. So I think, continuing to the 19th with a you know, I think 30 days following that is eminently reasonable to get us where we need to be given what I've just discussed with you, and I think, you know, it's fair play. We've done the same for you, and we're asking you to do the same for us.
Yeah, and I appreciate, I mean, that, you know, that, well said. I mean, there's a lot of good points, and I agree with almost everything you just said. I'm just trying to figure out what, I mean, what's changed on this plan is a parking layout's changed. The number of units is 68, so, I mean, you know, we're not going to redesign the inside of the building at this point until we know we have a plan, and then that will get looked at by a ton of people, the town staff, that will end up paying for additional reviews after. And we added what seems to be, if it was up to the board, a loading zone. The best place, if you're going to put one on site, is on that side on Lincoln, as opposed to somewhere else in front of the building or in the building. So I'm just trying to limit seeing what the scope of why we should not, you know, there's no new information on our end unless there was a something from a peer reviewer that said you need to do X, Y, and Z, and then we had to submit a new plan. And but that would happen, that may still happen nonetheless after the fact during the period between when it, the decision's rendered and when anything else would happen. So I just want to, so I could clarify, because I at the last meeting we did the straw poll just so we knew where the board was, and we've addressed those, and it may not be that any of us are experts to say that works, but I'm just trying to see if that's, are we limiting to see, does that parking layout work, and does is a loading space there, and any of the other, and still, you know, things that come with doing it, are those appropriate and do those work, or are we just saying it's an extension for whatever, because people talked about peer reviews and engineers and this, and all that stuff, the town council will tell you, a lot of that stuff usually gets conditioned out and say, you have to do this, and that's part of the decision, and final plans have to do that, and the project has to comply, just like if we said, we're not changing our parking ratio from 1.0. We believe that's the right ratio, we've supplied facts about it, we believe that would hold up in court, and you said, nope, we're conditioning that it has to be 1.25, here's your decision. We would then say, all right, neither we have to conform to that or we have to appeal to HAC. And if we conformed, we would still work with town engineer and say, here's our new plan that complies with the conditions of the zoning board. So I don't know if I'm making too much sense on that. I'm just trying to figure out where we stand, maybe town, somebody could, you know, on those issues.
Thanks, Matt. Other board members might have other points to make on this, but I mean, one thing that I'd add that would be very difficult, I think, for the board to figure out if we close tonight and I try to do it in the form of conditions is the following. You've presented, and I think the board appreciates this, several different loading zone configurations. Even if you take the one off the street, there's a couple different places you propose to put it. I think in terms of having it reviewed, it would be useful for the board to hear that they work. All of them work, if less than all of them work, but it would be helpful to have the input from the reviewer so that the board could figure out what the best option is with respect to where the loading zones, given the options you've presented, which what is the best location for the loading zone?
Right.
We agree with that, but yeah. That's one issue, and the parking ratio is one issue. I understand what the board has said tonight relative to the frustration of receiving the plans late. I'll make the point that you have a draft decision that's ready to review now, that the entire board can get tomorrow and have until January 19th to review exhaustively. So no one should have the justification of, I just got the decision, I haven't had a chance to review. So the entire decision can be looked at, and then you have two, so you can come equipped with all your comments and ideas on the 19th, and then we have two issues that are open that you need input from your consultants, which we're prepared to give you time. So I still have a hard time understanding why you need 30 days from the 19th to prepare a decision when everyone will have read it, all the comments could have been submitted to Chris, and you have two issues left. So I think that's what we're having difficulty understanding.
Well, you know, I don't want to talk this into the ground. Maybe some other board members, I don't know, I think some other board members may want to add something, but I think at this point we're starting to go a little bit in circles. We told you why we want the time that we want. I think we've given you some justification for that. We've heard what your concerns are, and I understand time is money, and that's a factor. I think really while we're getting a 30-day calendar day extension-ish, to, you know, the 19th, that there doesn't, not really 30 days of meaningful time. And I think we've also then shaved off 10 days from the statutory time for delivering a decision. And I don't think that's unreasonable. I think you've been reasonable with us, and I think that's being reasonable with you. So, you know,
I think my point was more, when we took the struggle, like, where do we, you know, we the waivers were revised. Some came off because we didn't need, like, the lodge shape anymore. We took off a couple others that town pointed out. We revised some working with town staff, who pointed out a couple errors, and we made sure they were all hopefully 100% accurate. We added one new one based on a comment from the town engineer, which was, if the loading zone is there, there's a provision about 30 feet access for in and out of lots. And this kind of falls into a gray area, so whether we actually need it or not, it's safer to put that on than not. And that literally came about just today from getting a memo from the town engineer. So again, it's not a question of understanding what the board is looking for to review. It's just, I just want to make sure that, you know, if we went over those waivers now, there's not something we're missing that's going to come up on the 19th, because, you know, we provided everything we can provide, and there may be some tweaks, but there's going to be tweaks anyways. I mean, that's the nature of these after a closing and decisions rendered and whatever happens. It's going to get changed. So I just want to make sure we're not missing something.
I understand your concern. I don't think you're missing anything. And I believe what you're saying, okay? But we haven't educated ourselves to know what you say is accurate. You believe it's accurate. We don't have any reason to doubt that it's accurate, but we don't have the information to know. So we're going to wait for deliverables from our peer reviewers. Take that into consideration. Likely close the hearing on the 19th. And then if there's anything we have an obligation under our process that we need to do or deliberate about, I don't understand, but are we really just stuck on that extra 30 days?
Let me be a little more blunt. If the peer review comes back and says, parking works, a couple spaces aren't ideal, but it works, loading space there, you know, not 100% ideal, like nothing ever is, but it works, you know, it's not to the level that it's an egregious safety violation. The parking layout works. It may not be ideal for some of the people in some of those spaces, but you know, that's more of a matter of convenience than a 40B thing, but it works.
I think what you're talking about, perhaps, you know, again, it's all fair. I don't want to overburden town council and town staff to the extent that they may find it a burden, presuming the board wants to meet and discuss it further. And I want to be sensitive to your schedule, obviously, but also town staff and town council schedule, and I don't think that's unreasonable.
Maybe we're just talking about two different things. I'm not talking about the time frame. I'm talking about the results of that review. Is that, last time I heard, again, the conditions went through, okay, those are acceptable. Here's what we wouldn't find acceptable. If those are found to be acceptable, if you took the straw poll, would then that be unacceptable if those do end up working like I believe they do? Or if they don't, they need to be revised, and they do, you know, if an engineer says space 12 really should be configured this way, can you make the change? And you make the change. But if those, I just, given where we were last time, and that was what the feedback we got, you know, I wouldn't want to go through this process for them to say, all right, I know you did the X, Y, and Z, but, you know.
I think, Matt, I'll be even more blunt. I think what my client is saying is we don't want to find out that the parking works and the loading zone works and have the board say take a floor off the building or you know, chop that off or something, because then we've just, in good faith, given you an extension and whatnot. So, it's an exaggeration, but I think what we're saying is we think we're close. Hopefully you think we're close. And if we solve these last remaining issues, hopefully we have a permit that, you know, is kind of, it's not perfect for my client, it's not perfect from the town, but it's something that I think is a compromise that, you know, hopefully can work. I think that's what we're fumbling around with.
You justify compromise. Go ahead, John.
Matt, Jeff, team. I've been associated with the board for quite a few years. I sat 5 40Bs here today, two large, three small. And the history of this board over the time that I've been associated with it has been a very reasonable group of individuals who look for every reason and every option to give the person what they're looking for within reason. What you're asking for here is what the board has done for the last 30 years that I'm aware of. And you're asking for a guarantee, Matt. There's nothing guaranteed. However, this board needs to give you a positive decision on the 40B that you're asking for and the conditions that you're asking for. Not the conditions, the scope of the development that you're asking for. What the board does is look at everything, and certainly if one space is not going to make it, and you could knock down to 1.24, I don't see that as a major issue, at least in my mind. I can't speak for the rest of the board members. But the board wants to make this right. We're wasting time getting over this. But when was the last time that you wrote a contract for a person renting one of your units and leaving everything open for the person? You can't. You've got to have specifics down there. All we're asking for is let's get the rest of the specifics here with the people that we need so we can spell it out in the conditions. And you're concerned about changes. That's why I asked town council. I've been through this before. There's always going to be changes, as you said. What's the direction? You don't want to have to come back to this board and say, we need a major change here because something doesn't work, and now that's a substantial change. So we got to publish a whole new hearing, and we're going to be 90 days out anyways before we can do anything. What is 90 days going to do to you? It's going to kick that living out of you. But anyways, the board is just asking for sufficient time to go through this. And in the January the 19th is not an unreasonable.
And so to add to what John said, I think I can answer your question. Last time we went through a waivers list, we gave you guidance on where the board came down on those waivers. And you came back with an updated set of waivers, which are in some cases similar, in some cases different. And in the case of the similar ones, I don't see, in my opinion, I can't speak for the other board members, in the case of the ones that are similar to the ones that were on the first list, I don't see the board's position changing on those. Okay, with regard to the newly presented, there are no guarantees, but I'm speaking to you from my perspective to try to answer your question, because I know where you're getting at. From that perspective, I don't see the board's position changing on those waiver requests that were the same or similar to those presented in the first list of waivers, original list of waivers. With regard to the new list of waivers, those are the ones we're going to be looking for peer review on, but we have an obligation to make a complete review of that list. You know, I don't think as I sit here right now that what we told you with the prior list is going to change. I can't guarantee you that. There are no guarantees. But as I sit here right now, I can stand by the fact that the waivers that we commented on last time, to the extent that they haven't changed, I don't see the board changing on them from my perspective.
Thank you.
All right?
In terms of the waivers, there's two new ones on here. Well, one was we asked for a waiver on off-street loading, but now we've given some options. Can I ask the board if their preference, if it is a safe preference, would be to have the one shown there as alternative to, say, right in front of the building on our property or in the building? I mean, can we just discuss? So we know maybe there's more detail we could provide on that to whoever's reviewing it. That space is actually 17 feet wide, and it doesn't really need to be. you're really only going to use 12, but we made it 17, so it, you know, was there. But if that's an important waiver that we were down to, that was an issue last time, and that was the place we put it. With that, is that, you know, going through that same, you know, kind of exercise we did last time on the, you know, needing a loading zone, that's where we feel maybe the best solution. But I'd be interested to hear the comments, not if it works and from a safety that a peer review will look at, but from general, if the peer review is okay, is that something the board would be okay with? Is that a fair question or too much?
I'm not sure that the board is ready to answer those questions for you yet. Again, we've seen what you've showed us tonight. I would want to see a little bit more and learn a little bit more about it before I can tell you this works, this doesn't work. That's what this extra 30 days is for.
Right.
Okay? And so probably within that time, with any luck, town staff will be able to communicate with you about whether or not those issues that you just raised are an issue, so you can have as much time, and we can give you the benefit of the doubt, so you can have as much time to come back to us on the 19th with a response, okay?
Exactly.
And so that's what we hope for. That's what we've hoped for all along, going both ways. And so that's what we're shooting for. I don't know what's gonna happen between now and the 19th. I may get hit by a bus, okay? So between now and then, I can tell you that we will engage with town staff and our peer review consultant to review the updated list and the updated plans. When we come back on the 19th, you know, if you want to have an agreement today about how long we're going to have to render a decision, we've given you a 10 days off before.
We don't need
days.
That today.
All right.
We don't need it today.
Okay.
What I'm looking for clarification is, okay, if we come back the 19th and is it going to be all right? Well, you actually need 3 loading spaces or 4 loading spaces, and that one isn't sufficient. That's the type of guidance, because we're going to do the work and make sure they work from a safety standpoint with what we proposed. But this is what we proposed. We're not proposing something different. So I think that's one guidance we're looking for. And I appreciate John's comments on the parking and that. And that's, we want it to work. And if the board's comfortable having it peer reviewed, we're willing to wait. And at this point, we'll wait till the 19th and see where the board is on the 40-day decision. We'll extend the hearing to the 19th, and we'll leave it up to the board. I think it could be done immediately. But let's see what happens the 19th. I'm also very confident those two issues can be dealt with very quickly. And given the holidays, it's just the way it falls. So it's the 19th. I'm just looking for the guidance of there's not a surprise. You come back the 19th and it's, you know, we said 1.25. We really want it to be 1.4. And I know that doesn't sound
like
we'll
be as transparent with you as we've been throughout the entire process,
right,
as we work through the next 30 days of peer review. Town staff has been transparent with you as well, and as soon as we get feedback back, we'll reach out. Town staff, I'm sure, will reach out to you as swiftly as possible. That said, thank you very much.
I hate to follow up on that one point, but the loading zone, I just want to make sure I'm hearing you right. We asked for a waiver for 0. The board took a straw poll that we do need something. We're proposing something that clearly needs to work, and it may not work, and it may show that it needs to be somewhere else. But is the board comfortable? And there's no guarantees, but the same straw poll that gave us the guidance to say we better go back and try to find a loading zone, or else we're gonna, you know, we could end up appealing this decision. The same guidance now would help us to say, is one loading zone that does work on the site something that, again, it's not a guarantee, it's just the guidance, same as you gave us last time, that 0 didn't work. We're asking, does one work? And you were able to give us the guidance that 0 didn't, so I'm just asking for the same guidance now.
I don't feel confident to answer that question right now. My apologies to you. I know you're looking for an answer. Perhaps if I was able to answer that question, we wouldn't be looking for a continuance. So I think that's wrapped up in everything that we need to discuss and get firmed up, hopefully prior to the 19th.
Yeah.
But when we get here on the 19th, you'll have any guidance, any clarification that we can provide to you that gives you a roadmap of where we need to go to get this done. All right?
I'm not comfortable as much with that. I'm comfortable giving you the time to review the safety on it. Just having that guidance would have been nice, because if we come back the 19th and say, guess what, we really want two, we're like, well, neither we're revising it, but we're closing it, and we're going to HAC over it. So
Matt, a lot of things would have been nice, right?
Right. So,
I'm doing the best that I can, and we're doing the best that we can for you. We understand you're doing the best that you can for yourself, and your staff is doing the best that they can for you as their client. I think we've come to a consensus, and with all due respect, I think we've talked our way to a point where I think we have at least a reasonable comfort level that we're going to get where we need to get by the 19th and be able to render a decision in a reasonable time after that. And I think the 19th works for town staff, 19 works for you. I would propose, I want to cut you off, so if you feel like you want to add anything to the record, please do. But I would propose that the board vote on the continuance right now and close tonight's portion via a continuance.
I mean, I think we're okay with that. I think we would ask the following. One, that, and I know town hall is closed on Friday. Monday, the peer reviewers are contacted with the clear scope of services as to what is required and expected, so that they are well informed as early as possible what's needed. Two, the draft conditions, the draft decision is circulated to the board in its entirety. That can happen Monday morning as well. Why?
There's no staff in on Monday.
Right, so Tuesday.
All right, and the waivers, I include that. So everybody, by the 19th, presumably will have plenty of time to look at the decision, plenty of time to look at the waivers, and they'll be waiting on bated breath. Hopefully they'll have seen weeks in advance from the peer review, and then we'll have a productive discussion on the 19th.
That sounds fair to the extent that town staff will endeavor to meet your request. I know they are all hardworking, and we'll try to make contact as soon as possible with whoever they can contact as soon as possible. That sound fair? All right.
And Matt and I will be in touch first thing in the morning about a written putting all this in writing, the extension in writing.
And so I will entertain a motion from a board member to continue the public hearing until Thursday, January 19th, 2017. Second?
Second.
Second, Cy. Any discussion? All those in favor? Any opposed? All right, we're continued until the 19th of January, 2017. Thank you, everybody. I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second? All those in favor? Thank you. The meeting is adjourned.